There's no place for argument. You are God all by yourself. You were God from beginning to the end. There's no need for argument. You are God all by yourself. You've got times and seasons in your hand.
You call for light out of darkness.
You're going to be the man.
You're going to be the man. God, you are, but you have chosen to call me your own.
You are God
from beginning to the end.
There's
no place for argument. You are God all by yourself.
Father, we give you praise. Go ahead and exalt his name one more time.
From beginning to the end, there's no place for argument. You are God all by yourself.
We give you praise. For in Jesus' name we worship you. Please let me say that briefly. Hallelujah. Can you help me extend a hand of fellowship to somebody? Tell the person you're welcome. It's good to have you around this evening. Good to see you. Hallelujah. We want to see how far we can go. Actually, what we have in store for Believers Authority is a three-part series, actually. But I'm doing my best to see how to squeeze the truth of God's word into, you know, two-part series so that we can understand and be able to apply them in our lives. You see, the last thing we are supposed to be treating in this series is administrations of spiritual authority or believer's authority, how to administer authority. The second part was supposed to be the laws that govern believers' authority. And by introduction, please follow me. By introduction, I want you to understand that man was created to be in charge over the creation of God. He was designed to have dominion over the earth and everything related to the earth. By design, man was wired to have dominion. It's like, is there something we can do? Okay, let's. It's weird. Yes. I don't know why fan is speaking louder than the microphone. Amen. Can you hear me clearer now? I think it's better now. So I said man was given dominion over the earth space. He was given to be in charge, in full control over the creation of God. Actually, God made it so. And God did it in such a way that man was created in his image and his likeness. These were the possibilities that God made available to man that gave man the authority to be able to supervise what happens on the earth. God created man in his image so that man can sustain his most current revelational position. I've said this before that in physics, there's something called image. In physics, there's something called a mirror image. But in scriptures, the Bible calls us the image of God as relating to the express image. If you study Hebrews chapter 1, you are going to realize that Jesus was called the express image of God. In a mirror image, there is still a dimension of imagery to a level of perfection, but it is not very perfect. The reason is because if you stood before a mirror before coming to this place and you lifted your right hand and you waved, the part of the mirror that is going to be waving is not the right part of the mirror. The mirror will be lifting the left hand because it's a mirror image. As beautiful as that image is, it still does not sustain the most current position. So it is changing position relative to how you are standing. But when we talk about the express image of God as pertaining to Jesus, we are talking about the most current revelational image of God. If you take a picture in your phone today, and after today you go back to your phone wearing a different shirt, the image of you in the phone does not change. It means the image the phone sustained is the image of yesterday. It could be the image of last year. It could be the image of 10 years ago. But if we begin to talk about a current image, something more recent to properly harmonize your state with God, that picture will not be able to sustain that capacity to represent you in that form. Because by the day you grow, the same way the glory of God changes in heaven, the energy that God emits changes in heaven, the activities that go around his throne changes. And so for man to be in his image, it means God installed his spirit in man to be able to pick the signals of God per time and act the way God is acting at that time. So if God was standing, it means man is standing. If God was sitting, man is sitting. It means the most current form God takes per time. And as the image of God is the most current form, the image of God is expected to take part time. Do you understand what I'm saying? So man was made in the image of God. And I said the part of man that has capacity to operate like that is the spirit of man. Not the man's body. Not the soul of man. So the spirit of man is in constant synchrony with God. Especially if you are in fellowship with God. But to translate that reality to the earth, there's another thing God gives you, his likeness. So the likeness of God is the anthropomorphic dimensions representing God. For instance, there are scriptures that talked about the breadth of his nostril, suggesting that God has a nose, right? And then a nostril. There are scriptures that talk about the palm of his hands, suggesting that God has a hand and then has a palm. So the likeness of God is the part of you also that God gave you, so that when your spirit takes a shape, your physical body can adjust to represent those dimensions. So the likeness of God talks about those anthropomorphic dimensions. It doesn't mean God is exactly like that, but it gives you a picture of what God is doing. It doesn't mean God raises a hand, no. But that's the expression we can bring in that dimension so that you can have understanding. And so God has put man in this mode, and then at some point, man lost what God gave him. What God gave man was not money. What he gave him was not a business. What he gave him was not a career. He gave man glory. He gave man authority over the earth. So what the devil deceived man into thieving from him is man's authority. You must understand this. Whenever the devil deals with man, he deals with man on the basis of deception. The devil does not win until you are deceived. And I've told you that a deception is not a lie. If I tell you that the shirt I'm wearing is a brown shirt, you can tell yourself, this guy doesn't know colors. It's possible he has color blindness. You can have an argument because of your own knowledge of colors. Is that true? Is that true? But if I get you to a point where you believe that the shirt I'm wearing is actually brown, meanwhile it's white, it means you have been deceived. So the purpose of a lie is to get you to a point where you eventually become deceived. That's what the devil does. So he uses all manner of means to lure you, to get your attention, until he gets you to that place where you are deceived. This is what happens to people. You know, you remember in our retreat, somebody raised the question, a very sensitive question, that if your mother is sick, for instance, and they tell you the only way to heal your mother is by traditional means, and then this is your mother, you love your mother so much, and somebody is telling you, maybe an uncle or somebody is telling you, bring your mother, let's take your mother to the native doctor so that they can administer healing or whatever kind of help they intend to administer by the help of a negative spirit. What the devil is doing indirectly is to bring you to a point where you can agree that power is not in God's hands. Yes. He tries to manipulate situations to get you to that point. What does the Bible say about us as believers? For instance, in Matthew chapter 5, it says, ye are the salt of the earth. Ye are the light of the world. You wake up one day and challenges of life eat you in a way that you begin to doubt, am I still what God says? It's bringing you to a point of deception because the words of God are true. What is true is what God said. Not the suggestions of the devil. Not a circumstance. And this is why if God says you are rich, you are rich. Yes. If God says you are not sick, you are not sick. But the devil wants to bring you to a point where you can accept it. When you accept something that is no longer true, then deception has set in. He met the woman. He says, did God really say that you should not eat of this tree? Hope you know if you study your Bible carefully, you realize that man was not deceived. I've taught this in this place before. That the person that was deceived was the woman, not the man. You don't want to agree with me on this? Yes, there are scriptures to prove that. Man was never deceived. Actually, man fell for love. That's the truth. You know, you know, in a marriage situation where your wife brings an opinion that you know for married people, that this thing is wrong. But you just look at it and say, well, let peace reign. Let's just enjoy ourselves. Let there be no problem. Let's do. You know, we'll still hit the rock and come back. But you know, the extent of damage won't be so much. It's something we can manage. Usually, men are not deceived. Usually. Yes. Men choose to yield. The person that was deceived is the one. This is why, you know, I've told you when I was teaching us on marriage codes, that why God places so much emphasis on wisdom for the woman is because she has capacity to be deceived. Why God places so much emphasis on submission for the woman is because it is in her not to submit. And so God begins to make emphasis on the things he expects them to adjust to begin to accommodate on time. For instance, the Bible never said man should submit. No. He asks man to love your wife because man can love a lot of things. You can love his sister in the morning. Love another one by 12. Love another one in the evening. Love another one tomorrow. And after marriage, you will still be loving. And because of the way man loves, he can tell you, I'm in love with three women and truly he's in love with them. But his love doesn't enter. It's a logical kind of love. He's just there. And so the Bible gives an instruction. Man, love your wife. Because there's a lot you can do with that. Are you following me? So that emphasis was there because it's in the capacity of a woman. The Bible says a wise woman. Why not a wise man? Are you following me? 1 Timothy chapter 2 from verse 14. Quickly, let me show you something before I continue this. 1 Timothy 2, 14. Look at this. Can we read? Want to go? Again, and Adam was not deceived. Because many people can assume the person that was, you know, I had to read this in black and white so that you don't think it's something I inferred by reason of study. No. Adam was not deceived. He played to love. Yes, that was what happened. Let's just do it. Let it not be like we are fighting. That was what he did. He was pressured to a point where he just accepted. Adam was not deceived. But the woman being deceived was in transgression. Hello? Are you listening to what I'm saying? So this was how man lost authority. The devil did not speak to the man. The devil spoke to the woman. If we must get the man, let's go through the woman. Are you aware the devil is still using this strategy today? Yes, the strategy has not changed. So it takes a lot of wisdom so that the woman can be strong, she can be solid. And then if you are a man, train your wife to that. Don't assume she has it. Don't make assumptions. And also don't say, they have chicken brain. No. It is now your responsibility to culture her and then surround her with sufficient. sufficient wisdom so that she's immune to the deceptions of the devil. There are many reasons why she's so. If you study the Bible, which I don't have time because this is not the scope of what I'm teaching. If you study the Bible in the book of Genesis to find out how the woman was deceived. When they brought the fruit, when they showed her the fruit, she saw that it was beautiful to behold. One, there was beauty. So she was attracted to beauty. Are women still attracted to beauty today? Yes. Are they still attracted to flashy things? Yes. As soon as she saw it, she said, wow, I would like to have this one too. And then, that was how deception began. Secondly, she said, it is good for food. This is why women, we still love cooking. Let's just try something out. Let me stop there. Well, we'll have real issues again in August, first week of August. Prepare. I'll be teaching on broken homes and broken hearts. First. Amen. Are you still with me? Yes, broken homes and broken hearts. First Saturday of August. That's we'll take time to deal with some of these things. So I'm showing you the process that it took man to eventually get to a point where he lost what God has given him. So what he lost was dominion. Right? Now, after man has lost dominion, lost authority, the whole process of bringing man back to the place where God placed him before is what we call redemption. Redemption is the name given to the entire process that God went through. The fact that God came down, slaughtered an animal and covered man. That God sent prophets to prophesy. That God said, the head of the serpent, the seed of the woman shall bruise the seed. You know, that scripture. All those processes until the time Jesus came, died, and resurrected is what we call what? The redemption. It was the redemptive plan of God. And the purpose of redemption is just to restore man back. That was everything God was trying to achieve. Not necessarily to make man more powerful. No. Not to increase his per capita income. No. It's just to bring him back to the initial position where man was supposed to be. Please follow me. This is introduction. What is authority? Let's go to the scriptures. First definition of authority I have here. Authority means power and right. Authority means one, power and right to make decisions, command and enforce obedience. Authority is not only power. Authority is not only right. Authority is a combination of power and right to make decisions, to command, and then to enforce obedience. If everything you have is right, you can't enforce obedience. Yes. Because you get to circles where something happened many years ago. Maybe I should just share this story. When we were in secondary school, there was this guy that we call it Izoabu those days. You jump the school fence and go out to get things done. And there was this guy that did it. And he was my friend. So he was coming back, and after then, the school was becoming so bad that we needed mobile police people to be our security. That the security men at the gate is mobile police. The security men that governs you is not security men as per security men. It's Mopo. They bring. So, and in this case, one of the Mopo men, when the guy was returning, jumped back. And then, one of the Mopo guys caught him. And then held him. His name was Echezoma. They held him in the waist. They were about to take him to the security station. But this was in the hostel area. That was where he came in from. And then boys started coming out from the room. One after the other. What did he do? Before you knew it, 5 boys, 6 boys, 10 boys. And then we heard the Mopo. Held the Mopo. Some people started slapping him. Some people, there was no choice. It was him alone than to leave the brother. This was secondary, SS2, SS3. You can imagine what. And these guys are in the society now. You know what they will be in society. So they started doing, before you knew it, 20, 30. When people saw the confidence they were using to slap, other people, you know, from back everywhere, they removed his trouser. And honestly, when the man found a breathing space, he ran. And the truth is that there was nothing he could do to us. We are students. The best he can do is to report to the school. It's not like military, where you say you will carry a gun and come and start. No, there was nothing like that. At the end of the day, he didn't know the person he caught. Doesn't know his name. Doesn't know his house. He just saw somebody that entered. He knows he's not. He's a student. And then, you know, the whole embarrassment started. And then nobody was held responsible. Nobody. What the man has is authority. He was licensed to do what he should do. Is that true? Yes. The school gave him authority. Federal government permitted him. You can carry out this kind of action. But in carrying out his action at that point, there was no power. If the man had a gun, we might not be close. You know, you still don't get what I'm saying. Because gun is where the power factor is. But go and stop people is what? Authority. Authority. If what you have is power, without authority, you are still illegal. Yes. Then if you have authority without power, you won't be able to enforce obedience. So authority is a combination of both power and right. That's license. To be able to command, decide, and enforce obedience. Number two, definition of authority. Authority is the influence a person wields on account of mastery. The influence a person wields on account of mastery. Please look up. You see, I will take time another time to teach us on mastery, what mastery really is. But there was a man in our school then, Professor Nock, that's his name. Professor Nock at a point was the number one biochemist in Africa, number one. He I think he advanced in biotechnology and even was the last commissioner for the previous commissioner for education before this commissioner for education that El-Rufai appointed in Kaduna State. So Professor Nock, because of his status, his extent of research, we call him an authority in biochemistry. Yes. When you have studied so much, you have learned so much, you have practiced so much, that you have mastery of what you are doing, then you are an authority in that area. It's the influence a person wields. A person wields on account of mastery. Two people can be having a conversation. Brushing two times is bad. Brushing once a day is bad. Brushing before meal is bad. Brushing after meal is bad. Have you been in that kind of argument? And people are just talking. And then somebody now says, we even have a doctor. Let's ask a doctor. Doctor, what do you think? What you are trying to say is that let's make reference to an authority. And you are willing to submit to whatever decision he makes. If he says once a day is right, all of you want to believe that once a day, not because he proved anything, but because there's an influence he wields on account of mastery. Are you following me? I hope you are with me. We are starting this thing. We'll still get to believer's authority. Please follow me. There are some things I want you to note. Because when we begin to talk about believer's authority, you need to realize that apart from being given power and license, you are given power and license over a place. Yes. Sometimes authority is localized. Are you aware that the president of Nigeria is not the president of the United States? Yes. And if he gets so angry, he cannot make law for the United States. And in case he chooses to be very, very angry, there's nothing he can do about the decision United States made, because the extent of his jurisdiction didn't get to that place. The highest he can go is within the bounds of his authority. In the creation of God, there are bounds of authority. That's what I'm about to show us. Please follow me. There are a few things to note. Number one, the kingdom of God is the totality, because we need to understand the concept of the kingdom of God. It's going to help us, and the concept of the kingdom of heaven, and then we bring a believer in so that you see the bounds of a believer's authority. The kingdom of God is the totality of the creation of God, where he is king over. I repeat, the first thing to note, the kingdom of God is the totality. Somebody said the totality. Yes, of the creation of God, where he is king. It is called kingdom because it is his domain. He's a king over that domain. The totality of the creation of God, where he's functioning as a king, is the kingdom of God. And the kingdom of God includes, like I said, all the creation of God. I'm going to prove something. You know, when we talk about the creation of God, I don't know what comes to your mind. But the Bible says in the book of Genesis, give me Genesis chapter 1, from verse 1, quickly. Genesis 1:1. Can we read? 1, 2, go. Everybody. In the beginning, God did what? Created what? Where did God create? The heaven and... this was the totality of the creation of God. Why I read this scripture is so that I can tell you. What about hell? Hello? Where is hell? Yeah. In the beginning, God created what and what? It's as simple as that. It's not like after this, God now went to make another place called hell. No. That's not, I'm just saying this just to tweak your mind, because my assignment is not also to tell you where hell is. Yes, but hell is in one of these two places. If there is any other thing you are going to be making reference to, it will be regarding these two places. Somebody might now say, why did the Bible say in the book of Philippians chapter 2 that at the mention of his name, every knee must bow of things in heaven, on earth, and so it is with reference to earth. Are you following? Yes. It's beneath the earth. So it means that region can still be referred to what? As earth. Hope you're following me. There are powers beneath the earth. There are powers in heavens. But what God made is, help me if you're in this class, the heaven and the earth. So as long as the heaven and earth remains, God is king over the heaven and the earth. The earth is the Lord's. Yes. And the fullness thereof, the world, and they that dwell therein. We know the heaven belongs to the Lord, but we also need to know that the earth is God's property. It's not anybody's right. If somebody says, this is our land, it's not your land. Our forefathers left it for us. It's a story. Yes, a real story. Because everything in the earth, including the people, belongs to God. They are all, and whether we like it or yes, they are within the heaven and earth. This is what God created. Number two thing I want to bring to your notice. Second thing to note. The kingdom of heaven are the regions where there is submission to that authority. churches where there is submission to the authority of God. Submission to the authority of God is when we call God Lord. Lord, that's owner. When we admit he's the owner. Many of you have lived in houses, maybe when you were younger, or even now, and somebody will tell you that's the landlord. When they say that's the landlord, what they are saying is that this land is not our land. The owner of the land is this person. Is the landlord. He cannot be landlord of everywhere. He can be landlord of a specified territory where he has authority over. He can't be landlord in another person's compound. So the place is where there is submission to that authority of God is what we call the kingdom of heaven. Follow me. How do we know a place has become the kingdom of heaven? Where there is a submission, because the principal person in the kingdom of heaven is Jesus. When Jesus becomes Lord and King, then the kingdom of heaven has come to that place. The Bible says in the book of, I think, Matthew chapter 4. Is it Matthew 4 or Matthew 3? It says, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is here. It means Jesus is here. He's expecting people to begin to adjust, to submit to his authority. When you gave your life to Christ, well, because, you know, there has been arguments, but actually, you didn't give your life to Christ. There was a problem with your life, and Christ wouldn't have done anything with this type of life. So when you received the life of Christ, yes, but that's what we say. Well, I know you understand what I'm saying. When that happened, you are led to make a proclamation to say that you are accepting Jesus as two things. One is your Lord. Two is your Savior. It means Jesus can be a Savior and not yet be a Lord. I want deliverance. Is there a way you can get it for me? And then you meet a man of God. He engages the power of God to bring deliverance. It doesn't mean he's your Lord. Because for Jesus to come into your heart, he has to knock. And if he knocks, you open. In our kingdom, we do not seek divine help. And then God assumes that on account of your seeking help, you have automatically subscribed. No. In the kingdom of darkness, when you want to seek help, they take you through a covenant process. I know you don't understand what I'm saying. Let me try to explain. If, for instance, a family is in poverty, for example, and they wanted help, they wanted divine assistance, God has to send us help. And then they want to assume they have been praying and doing everything right and God has not helped. Then they go to the devil and say, we want this, we want that. What the devil will do in exchange is to secure an agreement. He brings out a form. The devil won't give you and say, I love you so much, go and enjoy yourself. No, it's only God that does like that. And that's why people take God for granted. And this is why sometimes, before God begins to do the things you are praying about, he just waits until you make a decision to submit in totality. But the devil instantly brings out a form. What do you want? Money. What are you offering? Can we have an agreement? Then some people will tell him, we don't have anything, no. If we had, we would have brought it to you. But if you give us money, me and my children, and even my generation will serve you. That's a contract. It's an agreement. What you do not know is that the law is binding. The devil says yes. Actually, if you had brought money, it would have been less of an advantage. It was better you gave me your generation and your children's children. He takes his stamp and puts on it and says, signed and sealed. And then he begins to sponsor you. He begins to make finances available. One day, your baby wakes up and says, I'm not doing it again. I want to serve God. What he does not know is that before he was born, there was a bond secured. Hope you know why demons and evil spirits go into contract with people or prefers contract with people. It's because you can't live long enough to house them.
Do you understand what I just said? Yes. If you want to live long, how long do you intend you will live? How long? Who wants to live long? Tell me your age. When you want to die. Now, let me assume there's somebody that really loves this earth in this place. I want to stay for 200. Right? The demon you are going into an agreement with is not going to be here for 200 years. They have been here more than 1,000 years before you came. They have been here millions of years before you came. And they will be here years after you have gone. So when you say, I and my generation and my family will serve you, they quickly cling to that contract because it gives them legality over a space and they remain there. When you want to send them away, warfare begins. Shall the lawful captive be delivered? How does a man become a lawful captive? That's what the Bible is telling you. There was a contract. Are you following me? Hey, are you following me? Yes. Are you aware in some villages, in some local governments, in some extended families, maybe there was epidemic, maybe there was war, and then they contracted a spirit. We don't have what to give you, but if you can protect us, we will serve you. And then, as at the time the devil agreed with that contract, he provided security to an extent. So that if you want to fight them, you are not able to succeed. What those people does not know is that they have come under the influence of a spirit. Those kind of spirits are spirits we call principalities. Because they are governing spirits over territories, over places. Then, one day, you met Pastor Pascal preaching and you want to submit to the authority of Jesus. Well, when you are done submitting, you get back home, the spirit comes. And he said, you belong to me. What right do you have? You know, you might not know until something happens. Have you seen a goat before roaming the street and then you jam the goat and the owner comes? Before then, you thought there was no problem. There was no owner. Everything was fine until you touch it. Are you following me? Hello? Please, hello. Answer me. I need to be sure you are with me. You are learning. So demons are quick to jump into those kind of contracts. These are the things that lead to those contracts. And this is deception. He's telling you, I can do this, I can do that. You see, if you check demonic possession most of the times, you will realize that spirits generally do not want, how do we put it? You know, it was the Lord. I can't remember if it was Solomon speaking by the Spirit that said, David, that said that God does not dwell in temples made by human hands. In other words, and in the New Testament, in the book of Corinthians, the Bible says your body is the temple. So where God, generally spirits want to stay in bodies. And at best, bodies that were not made by hands. So, this building now, let me use this AC for instance. The devil might not want to be in this AC. You will hardly cast out a demon from the AC. Do you understand what I'm saying? You might not. But do you know you can cast out demons from trees? Yes. The earnest expectation of creature. Is that what the Bible says? They are groaning in pains and waiting for the manifestation of the sons of God. So, creature itself is waiting. Everything that God had created can be in pains. Demons can manipulate them. The devil went into a serpent. A serpent. They might not want to enter a speaker. They might not want to enter a microphone. Because they are not comfortable in things made by human hands. But they can occupy a mountain. They can occupy a river. They can go to the sea and live. And then if men want to secure contracts, they go to those locations. And they begin to have deal. Are you following me? I'm telling you why this is happening. Because normally spirits prefer creation. They prefer creation. Are you following me? Hello, are you still following me? The Bible says there are three that bear witness in heaven. And there are also three that bear witness on earth. The three that bear witness in heaven is the Father, the Word, and the Spirit. The Father, the Word, and the Spirit bears witness in heaven because they are the authority of heaven. They are the governors of heaven. And they are the longest existing beings of heaven. The three that bears witness on earth, the Bible says the Spirit, the water, and the blood, they bear witness on earth. And as a matter of fact, they are the longest existing beings. Huh. Can I ask you a question before I continue? You and your blood, which one is older? It means you are not the same age with the blood in you now. Yes. You can argue it, but I can prove it. Sorry, I don't need Bible to prove it. Your blood is actually older than you. Do you agree? Hello? You don't agree? If we check your blood, we can trace it millions of years where you'll be wondering, is it the same blood, this blood? Because your blood didn't begin with you. Your blood is way older than you. What do you think is the basis of bloodline covenants? What do you think is the basis? Haven't you heard of spirits that run in families? Haven't you heard of demons that run in families? How do they get there? You give birth to a child, it continues. You give birth to a child, it continues. Because when your forefather signed that contract with the devil, blood was there to bear witness. Are you following? I hope we can go very far today. So one of the things that bear witness on earth is the blood. This is where blood covenant comes into. People do contracts and involve blood. What they do not realize is that they are given authorization unknowingly to the operation of a spirit in that bloodline. And this is what happens. So your blood is older than you, way older than you. There is no wisdom in man to outwit the devil, none, except by the inspiration of the Almighty. No wisdom. You might come and say, I will be a strong man, I will be very disciplined. The devil can't get me. You are joking. The blood of your grandfather runs in you. That of your great grandfather runs in you. That of 10 generations ago runs in you. And if not for anything, even if there was no contract, he can study that blood and know the way your grandfather fell, the way your great-grandfather fell, and he can occasion situations to make sure you also fall. Because you are likely going to fall, the blood responds. No weapon fashioned against you shall prosper. It means that devil can bring you and keep and say, sit, and you sit, and then he checks your bloodline. Check your system. And then he fashions a weapon. He says, he tailor makes a weapon to suit you. I wish you understand what I'm teaching. Do you know, you might want to get a shirt and bring a designer, a fashion designer, a tailor, whatever you call it. And then the tailor comes and takes your size. Is that true? Takes your length. Takes the size of your trouser. Takes all the measurements and then fashions something that will fit only you. As soon as you wear it, there's a clinical perfection. This is what it is. This cloth is for you. The same way you can live your life by a kind of wisdom, hoping to outwit darkness, it takes a study of your blood for them to fashion a weapon that is your size. Yes. A weapon that will bring you, it might not bring everybody down, but if they bring it to you, you will go down. No weapon fashioned against me. It was fashioned not against us, against me. Ah, Jesus. We will expose the devil. You see, by the time we finish believers' authority, right, we would have exposed the devil enough. I don't know. When we were growing up, during Christmas period, I and my some of my brothers would go and know this thing that children do, that you should do Christmas for us. Ah, do Christmas for me, brother, do Christmas for me. And hello, did you do this thing I'm talking about? Am I the only one? And then while on Christmas, I don't know. And then some mischievous brother was able to say, P square. I buy up. Have you people been in that kind of condition where maybe you were five and a particular uncle gave one of your brothers 5,000 and says it's for all of you? And you people were not there. And then you come back to the house, your brother takes 1,000 or 500. I say, we are five. Everybody collect 100 naira. Does it happen around you? Okay, maybe it's angels that are your family. And then he gives everybody 100, they take 100 naira, take your 100 naira. And you people were even happy. He tried though. Only for New Year to come. You know, I have one of Christmas, one of the New Year. I love it. And then you meet the same brother and say, ah, brother, one of the New Year. And then he tells you, maybe your brother that they gave the money was there. But when you get 5,000 to go and share with your brothers. What? And after your brother gave you people the 100 naira, he was flexing. He was buying suya. He was buying. You people even beg in church, give me some. And you don't know what he's spending. As soon as the brother now says, where's the 5K I gave you? You didn't give them. It dawns on everybody that it was actually. It was actually 5K. What will you do after that? You know, the devil can be playing around because you don't know. You are only subject to his manipulations because one person has knowledge and the other person does not. You know, but your neighbor does not, on account of what he knows. That hope you know all the people fighting the devil and saying there's nothing like devil. Even the devil knows they are stupid. Have you seen people that say there is no God? The devil made them say there is no God. But the devil knows. You don't understand what I'm saying? The devil himself is aware there's God. But he brought them to a place where they can argue. Come on, get away. How can you say there's God? God where? Which God? God is slow. God is. This is how people talk on the streets. And the devil that is in charge of them already knows. You know, if that's what deception is, getting to a point where you believe a lie. Everybody arguing the power of God, arguing the authority of God and the existence of God, are arguing in ignorance. And if you tell them, they will not agree. And they are so ignorant that the Bible calls them fools, irrespective of their academic qualification. And yet, the devil in charge of their life knows. The madman of Gadara said to Jesus, have you come to destroy us? Jesus, son of David. It means he knows. Since you are even son of David, we know you. Have you come to destroy us before our time? We know you. We know you have ability to destroy us. But the person under their control will be saying there's nothing like that. They are deceiving you people in church. What? Has anybody told you your pastor is brainwashing you? They got to that place because a spirit was talking to them. The spirit speaking to them knows that pastor is not, but he needs them to agree pastor is. So that he can destroy them. This is how the devil deceives people. Can we continue? So when Jesus becomes Lord and King over a place, not just King, but Lord church as owner. That's a lord. The word lord is the word Adonai. Adonai. It means my lord. Whenever you get to the point where you make that statement, not just with your mouth, but with your heart, right? It means you have been brought into the kingdom of heaven. This is how a man gets saved. If you shall confess with your mouth and believe what you are confessing to in your heart, that Jesus is. Hello, I thought you were with me. Then you are saved. And when that happens for you, it doesn't have to happen for your chair. Because every other thing under you that you have government over is brought under that authority. Adonai. Can you say, you are my Lord and my God? It means he's my owner. Can we continue? So I said, Lord means owner. It's the ownership of God. That's the Lord over a domain. And then king is his dominion. His rulership is felt. It's not everywhere that the kingdom of God is. That is the kingdom of heaven. Not everywhere. Hope man, you know the difference. Who doesn't understand the difference yet? Hello? Should I explain it again? Not everywhere that is the kingdom of God is equally the kingdom of heaven. I said in English so that you get it for the last time. The kingdom of God is everywhere the dominion of God is felt as king. And that includes heaven, earth, hell, and whatever you want to call it. The kingdom of heaven is everywhere that men are submitting to the authority of that king as lord, as owner. Not just as king now, but as owner. They have come to agree, you are my owner. That place is the kingdom of heaven, where the authority of Jesus is felt as lord. God is king over his creation, but not lord over everybody. Is that true? Yes. Not everybody has accepted him as lord. Not every community has accepted him as lord. Not every village has accepted him as lord. Not every man has accepted him as lord. But the day he's accepted as lord and king, then the kingdom of heaven comes into that place. And what happens at that instance is that a battle goes on in the spirit. A real battle you might not know about. Yes. From the days of the kingdom of heaven, there is violence, there is battle, there is a lot of warfare. Are you following what I'm saying? Yes. It began from the days of John. Why it began from the days of John is because John prophesied about the coming of Jesus. It was John that told us about that kingdom. And are you seeing the gospel of Jesus? The kingdom of heaven is here. Is at hand. Is here. It means what Jesus was saying is that subscribe to me. You know, man generally has authority, but a believer has authority that men generally do not have. I will show us. Let's continue. Now you know the difference between the kingdom of God and the kingdom of heaven. Is it settled, everybody? If it's not settled, just wave. All right. Let me try to explain, because this is instrumental to the study we are going to be doing. Something in this hall I can use to explain these two things so that we do it once and for all. You see, God created the heaven and the earth. Is that true? Genesis chapter 1 from verse 1. Okay, give me Philippians chapter 2. Philippians 2. Let's read from verse 3. Or maybe from verse 1. Then let's just run down. Philippians. Hope we have time. Let's start from verse 1. Let's just get the context. If there be, therefore, any consolation in Christ, if any comfort of love, if any fellowship of the Spirit, if any bowels of mercies, bowels of mercies, fulfill ye my joy that ye be like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord and of one mind. Verse 3. Let nothing be done through strife or vainglory, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem the other better than themselves. Next. Look not every man on his own things, but every man also on the things of others. Yes? Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. Yes? Who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God. Next. But made himself of no reputation and took upon him the form of a servant and was made in the likeness of men. So this is the likeness of men. So the Bible is saying that we want you to begin to think the way Jesus thinks. How did Jesus think? According to this scripture, it's portraying Jesus as a man having so much humility. It means in the mindset of Jesus is humility. And it's not humility as compared to a man having prosperity, or humility as compared to a man having influence. It's humility as compared to being God. Because though he was God, he did not think it robbery. He brought down himself, made himself of no reputation, and took upon himself the form of a servant. Next verse. Verse 8. Wherefore God also had highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name. The word name in this place is authority. Let me show you. Do you realize that when we are reading and we are coming down, the Bible says, let this mind be in you, which was in what? What is that name? That's his name. The Bible told us clearly, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. So, that's Jesus Christ. And then, the Bible now says, starts talking about a name. God has given him a name. So, it's assumed before now, he was not that name. There is a name the Bible is making reference to. And it's talking about his authority. Jesus is the being that the universe of God is willed to. Let me show you. Continue. Given him a name above every name, and I said his authority. That at the name, not. Hey, can we read this scripture one together? Stop. That the emphasis is at, not in the name. Hope you know we say in the name. Hello? Oh, you don't know the difference yet? At is a preposition. Is it a preposition? It's a preposition of a place. Prepositions talks about places. Is that not true? Right? In talks about something. At talks about something else. When you say in, what does it mean? In. When you say on, what does it mean? On. When you say under, it means under. When you say above, when you say behind, when you say in front of, are you following me? The preposition used here is not in. It's at. At means you came to the place. If you study the Bible carefully, because we're still going to get to this, the Bible said something about the name of Jesus not being a name. Yes, the Bible agrees that the name of the Lord, who is the Lord, Jesus, is a... So, the name is not just a name. There's a local government. Who is the Lord? Him. The name of the Lord. Thank you. So the righteous can come to a place called the name of the Lord. The righteous can get into a place called the name of the Lord. And the Bible calls that place a tower. It's an office. It's a headquarter at the name of Jesus. You see, people that have this revelation understand what it means. At the name and in the name. They have correlation, which is not what I'm about to share. I'm about to show you something about Jesus being Lord over creation. And at the point that God made him Lord over creation. And how that he's being Lord translates for him being the extension of the kingdom of heaven in creation. Let's continue. At the name of Jesus, what happens? Every knee should bow of things in heaven. Listen. So it means before now, we know there are things in heaven, but they have not all bowed. There are things in earth, but they have not all bowed. Are you following me? There are things beneath the earth, they have not all. Hey, does it make sense, this scripture now? So the Bible is telling us that at the name of Jesus, it means this technology started from now. Things in heaven, on earth, and beneath the earth, at his name, bows. And when they bow, what do they say? That's next verse. And every tongue, it's talking about humans now, should confess that Jesus is Lord. Listen, Jesus is Lord. The kings in heaven, earth, and beneath the earth knows that God is king. But they get to a point where they know and accept that Jesus is Lord. Does it make sense? Is it getting clearer now? So when we talk about the kingdom of God, we are talking about where the kingship, the dominion of God is felt. And that includes heaven and earth. But when we talk about kingdom of heaven, we are talking about those places that have come to a point where they accept that Jesus is. They are not just accepting Lord as Lord. They now accept that Jesus. They're not just accepting God as King. They have come to accept that Jesus too is Lord. That Jesus is the owner. He's Adonai. Following? Because this is a basis of spiritual authority. Why is the basis of spiritual authority? Is that you can get to places where demons will question you. Who are you? What are you looking for? How is this place your place? And they are asking those questions, checking your bearing. When I will teach you about the laws of believers' authority, I will show you. The law of alignment. That's the first thing we are going to deal with. Because your compliance to this authority is what gives you as a believer authority. Jesus, I know. Paul, I know. Who are you? This is a demon asking. We know Jesus. We know Paul. But you, we have checked you where we checked it. There's no compliance with divine authority. We cannot believe you, accept you. You can't talk to us. Who are you? And the Bible called them the seven sons of Lucifer. Their father was a pastor. Hello? 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 It's like I'm dabbling into confusing things. Is it a little clearer now, my dear? Is it a little clearer? Yes. So we have the kingdom of heaven. We have the kingdom of God. Let's continue. Number three thing I want us to note before we continue. Is that the summary of God's creation, which I have said again and again, is the heaven and the earth. The summary of God's creation is the heaven and the earth. Now, this will lead me to something else. Psalms 115. From verse 16. Follow me. There are two people with authority in the universe. believers of God. Two personalities with authority. Two, not three, not four. Two. The heaven, even the heaven, even the heavens are the Lord's. It means the governing authority in the heaven, even the heavens, Shammai and Shamayim, they are the Lord's. He says, but the earth. So, who is in charge in heaven? Is it making sense? There's a governor there. There's a ruler there. There's an authority there. He called that authority, not God. He called him the Lord, the owner. That's Jesus. He says, but the earth. Who is in charge of the earth? The children of men. In the creation of God, only two personalities have authority. Now, what why this is important? Let me tell you why. Are you with me? Hello? Hello? How will you feel? You know, there is something we call rank physically. If you have a knowledge of the police or army, there's something called rank. I don't know how they station their ranks. Maybe sergeant is higher than, I don't know how those ranks work. But I also know in the military we have a captain, we have a major above the captain, we have a lieutenant colonel above the major, we have a colonel above the lieutenant colonel. And then we have a general above the you know, that's kind of rank. Now, you can be higher in rank and be shorter in height. Does it make sense what I'm saying? Let me not use people for example. I wanted to. You can be higher in rank and be. When we check your height, you are smaller. But it doesn't mean you are small in rank. Are you following me? You know, why I made this statement is for the people that believe that because demons are demons or they are spirits, they have power over us. I wish this singular statement makes sense. One day, I think I was teaching my wife about necromancy. You know, there are certain places, certain families where there is something called the worship of the dead. People pay allegiance to the dead, give respect to the dead, honor the dead, pay attention to the dead, assuming that because they are dead, they should know better. No. It's not true. I can scientifically, I can prove it otherwise, not just scripturally. The Bible says a living dog. Let me preach to your neighbor. Let this one enter. If nothing enters today, we need to install authority here. If it's a dog and it's still alive, a lion that is dead is not stronger than a living dog. Find that scripture so that they see it for themselves. A living dog is better. It's better. Please say it's better. Say it like you know what you're saying. It's better. For people that receive instructions from their grandfather that died, and they say it's guiding me, it's not guiding you. A demon is guiding you. If you are alive, you are still better. You are wiser. I know you might not believe it because of your cultural upbringing. As a matter of fact, if they are the people you receive instruction from, it's necromancy without knowing. the worship of the dead. Because when they die, that's it. Dead is dead. If they are coming to tell you anything contrary, especially to what God has said, just know it's not your father. Do you know, as pastors, there are times people die in families and they bring ghosts, and then we pray and sever the living from the dead and tell them, don't have anything to do with the living again. You don't have anything to do with the dead again. We talk to them in that way. Is that true? What are we trying to tell you? We are not saying they will be coming to you. We are saying it's possible for a demon to take the face of who you think is your father and come and be talking to you. And it's not your father. And then you say, it's my father. He died since 2022. Therefore, if he has died, he died. Please, he died dead. Except he didn't die well. For to him that is joined to the living, there is what? Yes. For? Read it for yourself. A living dog. Can I add more to this proof? You know, it's authority. I'm giving you authority. You are now understanding your place. So that they don't meet you in the dream and they tell you nonsense. Tell them to get away. You are not my father. You are not my mother. You are not anything. Your mother was nice and peaceful when she was alive. And then she dies and comes to you in the dream. And she begins to fight you. Why are you using my plate to eat? Whose plate should I use? Is that your mother? Or why are you using my pot? You know how much I bought this pot? What? What's your business? Are you cooking there? Okay, come and carry your pot. If it's in my house, I will use it. Until you come and carry it. Are you learning something? Are you learning? I know this is challenging many people's thoughts and beliefs. A dead person is a spirit. Is that true? A living person is body and spirit. It's what? Body and spirit. Body and spirit are only spirit. Which is better? Because you are spirit, you have equal authority in their realm. Is that true? It means the same thing they can do as spirit. Are you not spirit? Why are we threatening you with ojuju, ojuju? I will never tell my children. You know that? Never. It can never happen. It's nonsense. Because they begin to indoctrinate us very early. Before we had children, I had called my wife and said, babe, I beg. We can teach these children everything, not fear. You shouldn't fear anything. The Bible actually says, you shall fear no evil. When it's evil, don't fear. If it's good, you can even fear good. They want to buy me a car, so I'm scared. They are buying me a Range Rover. Be scared. Be scared of the Range Rover. I'm so scared. Be scared is a good place to be scared. But if they say, I will kill you tomorrow. What did the Bible say? Fear no. Once you have identified yourself as evil, the Bible instructs us not to fear you. We can't fear you. You are evil. You don't say, I'm a native doctor. You know me, I'm a native doctor. Are you a native doctor? Yes. You know, the revelation intoxicates. Light intoxicates. You don't let people tell you nonsense. No. There are things you know, your mindset shifts. Even in your dream, nobody intimidates you. They don't know, but what's your business? I don't have any business with you. But you can stay and be arguing and be saying, I'm not really sure it is. I'm not really sure. Better be. That's why we're teaching you believers' authority, so that you can be sure. This is kingdom matters. Should I prove it more? Guys, if it is a spirit, don't fear. Let me prove it more. Angels don't have authority. I know this one will pain you more. Hello? Angels? No. If it is in heaven, who has authority there? If it is on earth, who has authority there? Men. If you say angels have it, where are they exercising it? Where is their authority? Where are they? Is it Hebrews chapter 2? Where the Bible says at no point has he called any angel son. He has not looked at an angel and called him son. I think we read that scripture, was it on Saturday? That one cried in a certain place saying, what is man? What is man? It means man is different. Man is special. Man is powerful. There is something man has that they don't have. And as a matter of fact, the person that cried in that scripture was an angel. Can you find that? Is it Hebrews 2? Is it Hebrews 2? For unto the angels had he not put in subjection the world to come whereof we speak. They are not in authority there. Next verse, verse 6. But one. So who is talking here? Hello, who is talking? An angel. See, testified and saying, what is man? That thou art mindful of him, mortal man. He's even paining them. He didn't just stop at man. He said, what, the one that can die, we don't die. Yet, he didn't give us authority. If you talk about power, I can tell you angels have it. Yes. There is no argument. The angels of God, they excel in strength. But in authority, they don't. This is why they are even given charge over you. Are they not ministering spirits sent to minister to those who shall be heir? Now, it means they are sent to be ministers. The word ministers there is the word servants. Between the servants and the oga, who has authority? Can I take it a little further? Demons too, don't. If I told you angels didn't have authority and you were happy, if I told you demons don't, you should be jumping. They don't. Yes. No demon has power over us. It means Jesus didn't die. Can I give you 30 seconds for this thing to sink? Demons don't have authority over me. And if, as we go in believers' authority, I will bring you to a place, because I told you angels have power. I will now bring you to a place where demons too, apart from authority, they also don't have power. Hello? They used to have it before. Jesus said, all the powers. How many of the powers? In heaven and on earth. He says, this has been given to me. And he says, as the Father has sent me, so send I you. So he's telling you with confidence, knowing that there is nothing there. Tell your neighbor, there is nothing there. And in places where they are really powerful, they are using the authority of men. But the authority of men is still not superior to a believer. You know, I told you there is believer's authority and there is men's authority. Yeah. Do you understand the difference now? Because as a man, we equally have authority. But when I come with believer's authority, a demon with understanding can capitalize on your authority as a man and say, we don't want. But a believer's authority still overrides that authority. You are greater than the greatest, higher than the highest. Odoguagakue, there is none like you. You are greater than the greatest, higher than the highest. Odoguagakue, there is none like you. You are greater than the greatest. You are higher than the highest. Odoguagakue. Are you seeing? Please believe what I'm teaching you. These are not cunningly devised fables. It's not like I'm coming to motivate you. No. No. We are going to need these things. These are the tools we use in spiritual warfare. You are in your house at night, and then a foul spirit wants to take your child. What do you do? Out in the name of Jesus. Leave this baby alone. You are not authorized in this space. Why will they listen to you? Now you know. They don't have it. But if the devil does it, and then chicken out. You know, I've told us that the greatest tool of the devil is one, fear, two, deception. When you are in honor, the Bible says a man in honor and does not know is like a beast that perish. Psalms 82. They know not, neither do they understand. As a result, they walk on in darkness. Can somebody shout out? There's something you are sending away. He says you can rebuke. He didn't say apologize. Do what? Rebuke. Don't try and then run away. No. Stand your ground. With understanding, with what I'm teaching you now. What right do you have to be here? And then in case you come and you are wondering, what is going on? What is going on? How can I do this? You know, there's no philosophy to it. There are many ways we identify demons. We don't need to see them. We see what they do. When you see somebody possessed with the spirit of madness, what will you see? A mad person. Is that true? You must not wait until you see the spirit hanging. If there's madness, it means look at the thing causing it. Address it like that. The more we do these things, the more we have a handle of it. Believe what I'm telling you. If today you have to say it 5 times before they move, tomorrow you say it 4. After 1 week, a time comes, you don't need to say it again. You are passing. Have you come? You've come again? At that point, you don't talk again. Everybody knows you're a troublemaker. So that you don't dream, and then somebody makes something in the dream, and then give you, and you enter your head, and you feel dizzy, and you wake up, and since then your stomach has been turning you, it was turning you, and now you are feeling like you are dying. Pastor, they were carrying all those things as to cock and bull. Somebody say cock and bull. It's cock and bull. You know cock and bull? Have you thought about cock and bull before. Where a chicken and a cow, a bull, is discussing. That's cock and bull story. Think about it. It's a real story. When they write it, how will the story be? What will a cock and a bull be discussing? It's cock and bull story. They're having a conversation. I think somebody will answer and say, who is really mad? And the cock said to the bull. And then if the person telling the story of what the cock said to the bull is mad, what about the person enjoying the story? Jesus came to a room. The woman was dead. He walked in. People were crying. Oh, oh. People that were hired. You know the way they cry in your village? They're not crying because the person died. If you listen to the content of the intercession, because it's who will give us rice. Oh, God has died. Who will be buying us bread? You know those lamentations? Do they do this in your place? Their pain is not the person that is who, what this we used to enjoy. Who will now bring this enjoyment? Jesus got there, looked at all of them and said, please, tell these people to get out. Some of them got offended. All right, let's see what you do. Please, just, madam, with all due respect, stay outside. We don't need noise here. They went out. He said, Talita. Talita. You have power and authority. I've not started my sermon. By the time we finish, your eyes will open. Believe what I'm telling you. Demons don't have power and authority over a believer. They don't. Do they? You see, I want to stop here. I don't want to, because if we press this in further, yourself no more cock and bull. If we don't bring the devil to his place, believers will fear him. And we'll be so scared of what is not in existence. This is true. We can live in fear all our lives. I'm training myself not to be reactional anymore. It's a deliberate training I'm doing to myself now. You tell me all the bad things, I tell you, wow, it's really bad. So, sir, what do we do? Of course, there's something we can do. Don't worry. Keep coming for the class. Authority is the authority we call a delegated authority. Believers' authority too is delegated. It's acting on behalf. God's authority is ultimate authority. Delegated authority is powerful because the person that delegated the authority to you will back it up. Yes. You might wait for God to come and use ultimate authority. When you have delegated authority, you wait for long. The best way to bring him is to release your own authority. Use it to act. What will he do? He will come and back it up. He backs it up because he sent you. Let his mind be in you. Some of you will have to take this sermon, listen to it 5 times until you extract all the juice inside. Do you know the more you hear, there's something it does to you? The more you hear, there's something it does to you. You know, the word of God makes you. makes you free. You don't put a water in freezer, cover it, open it, and say it's frozen. Is that what you do? The freezer makes the water to freeze. The longer it is there, the longer the molecules are compacting, they are coming together. Is that true? You leave it for one day, then you come, you realize it has gotten there. Some of us just hear it once and say, hey, I have it, and then you go out. That's not how it works. Was it John? Give me John 8:29. Let's end there. He makes you free. John 8:29. I think. I hope I'm correct. This is not the scripture. Give me 28. Where is the scripture that says who the Father has made free is free indeed? Is it 8? Huh? 8 what? 22. 32. Go to 32. Can we read from here? It says, and ye shall know the truth, and what will happen? The word there is make. Make. Like you go to where they are molding block, there are processes. If you finish the block and then you jump on it as soon as they finish, what will happen? But when you keep the block there for a while, carefully bring it out and leave it in a place, allow it to dry. If it was well made, you can even throw it up and leave it. It falls and nothing happens to it. Because it takes a while. It makes. Are you learning? This thing I just said is powerful, but it doesn't become powerful automatically. You stay with it. You stay with it. You stay with it. You stay with it in prayers. You learn word conversion. You change states of the word. Because the word as a spirit is powerful, but there's a way it can operate. The word as flesh is powerful. There's a way it operates. The word as scriptures is powerful. There's a way it operates. You learn the mode of God's word. You know, I've taught you about the modes of God's word, but I will take time and teach on that. How the word as spirit is still the word of God. But the Bible says, and the word that is spirit became flesh. It means it was not flesh before. It changed mode to become what? Flesh. And as flesh, there's a way it works. And the written word is called what? Scriptures. The Bible says the letter. That's what the Bible calls it. Wait. Wait. Take this sermon. I want to advise you. You won't lose. You won't miss. You build yourself in this consciousness. Build like you know it, like you know your name. God has given me power. God has given me authority. Demons don't have it. Angels don't have it. If we had time, I would have shown you. The Bible says that the angels of God, they hearken unto the voice of the word of God. They don't hearken to the word of God. They hearken to the voice. You give the word of God a voice and then angels follow. You are greater than the greatest. Rise up, let's pray and go. Higher than the highest. You are greater than the greatest, higher than the highest. There is none like you. You are greater than the greatest, higher than the highest. You are greater than the greatest. You are higher than the highest. You are greater than the greatest. You are higher than the highest. Odogwu Adakuwe.
are greater than